It's more than an uproar. I would say it's more of a celebration and a historic milestone. The reason is that the book itself is Leon Trotsky started.
This originally was published, or was due to be published, in 1941 in America. It's a book that Trotsky didn't finish because he was assassinated on the 20th of August 1940, and the book was only half complete with other sections in various states. But the person who was given responsibility to edit the book and to complete the book was a man called Charles Malamuth. He was originally just a translator of Trotsky's work, but the publisher decided he should be the editor. And as a result, he introduced into the text all his ideas, lots of interjections, interpolations, in the last half of the book, which in effect marred the book, ruined the book in one sense. In fact, it's 75 years ago, this year, that Trotsky's widow, Natalia Sedov, went to court to try and stop the publisher producing the book in this particular form. And it's therefore taken, 75 years to really correct this injustice, to publish the book without Charles Malamuth's comments and interpolations, and restoring a lot of the material that he left out of the book when he was editing it. And therefore, we believe that this is an important milestone in the defense of the ideas of Trotsky and his memory, and his political honor. Now, the speakers we have tonight will be Esteban Volkov, who is Trotsky's grandson. In fact, he was the biggest supporter of this project. He himself attempted to get this book stopped, the publication of this book stopped in 1967, when they tried to bring it out with an introduction by Beatram Wolf. Like Natalia in 1941, the legal action failed, and this book has been in print with this maligned political content for the last 75 years. Therefore, the person most fitted to speak to this meeting about this subject is certainly Esteban Volkov. I will give a brief outline of the history of the book, and then I will hand it over to Alan Woods, who edited the book and did a lot of the Russian translation of the book, and basically brought it into the condition it is at the present time. You might say it was a labour of love. It was certainly a labour, I know that. Given the blood, the sweat and the tears that went into this over the last 13 years, as a matter of fact. Now, Esteban Volkov is obviously closely associated with the name of Leon Trotsky. Esteban, well, his mother was driven to suicide by the Stalinists, and his father was arrested and taken to a Stalinist gulag where he perished. And Esteban therefore went to live with his uncle in Paris, Leon Sedov, But in February 1938, Leon Sedov was murdered by a Stalinist agent. As a result, Trotsky, who then moved to Coyoacan in Mexico City, wanted to bring young Sieva away from the dangers of Europe and the Stalinists and bring him to Mexico to live with himself and with Natalia. And therefore, in the summer of 1939, at the age of 13, he made the trip and traveled all the way to Coyoacan. In May of 1940, you had the first assassination attempt on Trotsky's life. And in that attack, where 25 armed men raided the fortress, firing machine gun bullets everywhere they could to try and kill Trotsky in particular, they failed in their mission, but they did actually wound Esteban in the toe. On the 20th of August 1940, when Esteban came home from school, he was faced with a crowd and the sad news that his grandfather had been assassinated. And really, ever since then, he has worked tirelessly to defend the ideas of Trotsky against the slanders of the Stalinists and also the bourgeois critics throughout all this time. And therefore, I would say this, as I said, there's no one more important for this meeting tonight than the contribution of Esteban Volkov. Here's Esteban. Please give a warm welcome to Esteban Volkov. Esteban, greetings. Hope you can hear us okay.
Okay. Alan?
Sí.
Hi, Alan.
Okay. Okay. I'll leave us alone to the experts. I'll just sit down and enjoy the speech.
Okay. Me veis ahora o no?
Okay.
Me ves, Esteban?
Español.
Me ves o no?
¿Vale?
Me ves?
Sí, perfecto.
Ajá. Okay.
Un poco de eco, nada más. Me distorsiona un poquito.
Sí. Sí.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Sí.
Okay. Desde el otro lado del Atlántico, mando un fraternal y cantoso saludo a tus camaradas, amigas y amigos, International Marxist Energy.
From the other side of the ocean, I send a warm fraternal greetings to my comrades and friends of the International Marxist Tendency. I'm afraid it's breaking up a little bit.
Sí. Eres, tras muy curioso, paciente esfuerzo, de más de 10 años, lograron rescatar y complementar última obra que inició, no pudo concluir, el revolucionario Leon Trotsky.
The comrades who for the last 10 years dedicated a colossal amount of time and effort to restoring and recreating the final work of the great Russian Marxist Leon Trotsky.
Se trata de Patricia Stalin, ya que fue asesinada por orden de este siniestro personaje el 20 de agosto de 1940.
This work could not be finished because its author was assassinated on the instructions of that sinister personage, Joseph Stalin, on the 20th of August 1940.
Quien manifestó o le profesaba gran miedo al compañero de armas de Vladimir Lenin.
That I'm afraid the sound is distorting seriously, you know.
¿Cómo?
Está distorsionando. Repite.
Lo manifestó Volkov, que tenía gran miedo de compañero de armas de Vladimir Lenin.
Stalin was terrified of the comrade in arms of Lenin, as I say, Trotsky.
Y trató impedir realización de esa obra.
And therefore he took great pains in order to ensure that this book should never see the light of day.
Como ya se ha mencionado en repetidas ocasiones, Trotsky se con desgane, con pocas ganas, con entusiasmo a la hechura de esta biografía.
I should explain that Trotsky undertook this work without any great enthusiasm. He did this reluctantly.
Básicamente, a la solicitud de Harper Brothers, que fue motivado por la situación de carencia, penuria financiera en que se debatía pequeña familia de Viena 19 en Coyoacán.
He was compelled to undertake this task as for financial reasons as a result of the conditions of extreme poverty and want that was being suffered by our little family here in Coyoacán.
Su mayor ambición, su mayor anhelo era concluir biografía de Lenin, de la que ya había hecho etapa de la juventud.
His real wish was to carry on the work which he'd begun on a biography of Lenin.
Sin la menor duda, la redacción de este libro acortó los días de vida de Trotsky.
There is no doubt at all that the publication of this book is a tremendous contribution to the memory and the ideas of Leon Trotsky.
La lista.
It's seriously distorting, you know. Very seriously distorting.
Yeah. Alan.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Sí, sí. Sigue.
Okay. Sigue.
La lista de los colaboradores en esta magna realización es demasiado larga para ser aquí mencionada, enunciada.
The list of people who have collaborated in the publication of this magnificent book is far too long for me to mention them all.
Pero sí debo mencionar el nombre del camarada Rob Sewell.
But I should mention the name of comrade Rob Sewell.
Quien fue iniciador del proyecto al incursionar en el manuscrito original de la biografía en la librería Houghton de la Universidad de Harvard.
Because he was the one that took the initial initiative in going to the Harvard University archives and digging out the original material that had been left out of this book.
Igualmente, debo mencionar la valiosa intervención del marxista británico Arthur, conocedor del idioma ruso y muy familiarizado las ideas de Trotsky.
I should also mention the British Marxist Alan Woods, with his knowledge of the Russian language and his deep knowledge of the ideas of Leon Trotsky.
¿Quién pudo cumplir el material mítico en edición original de 1946?
Who was able to put together finally an acceptable, a correct version of all that material that was left out of this book in the edition published, first of all, in 1946.
Realizada por el traductor e improvisador llamado Charles Malamud.
Which was carried out by the man who had been the translator of the book, Charles Malamud.
Personaje que fue contratado por Harper's por la editorial Harper's
This man had been contracted, had been taken on by the publisher Harper in order to conduct to carry the translation of Trotsky's work.
La cual tuvo un interés monetario sin ningún respeto a la histórica.
This man was purely interested in the book from a mercenary point of view and with no interest whatsoever in either its political or historical content.
Tan así que hizo oídos sordos a todos los reclamos de Natalia Segova, Judas Trotsky y de su abogado Albert Holman.
Therefore, he paid no attention whatsoever. He completely ignored the protests made by Trotsky's widow, Natalia Sedova, and her lawyer, her legal representative, Albert Goldman.
El camarada Burks también eliminó todas las anotaciones de Malamud, muchas en contradicción con sus ideas de Trotsky.
Comrade Alan Woods also eliminated all of the offensive additions put in by Malamud, many of which were in flagrant contradiction to the ideas of Leon Trotsky.
El camarada Alan Woods logró armar el material publicar en forma ordenada y en armonía con el pensamiento de Leon Trotsky.
He managed to put together all the material of this book in a logical sequence which respected the original ideas and intentions of Leon Trotsky.
Ese trabajo pudo hacerse gracias a un muy laborioso esfuerzo de compilación y mecanografía de textos poco legibles.
This work was also made possible originally by the hard work of comrades who actually typed out the original manuscript, which was not in a legible form.
Trabajo que realizaron camaradas y amigos de la International Marxist Tendency, IMT.
All this work was carried out faithfully by comrades and friends of the International Marxist Tendency, the IMT.
Logrando incorporar en 30-40% más de texto de valioso material a la versión original.
Which finally succeeded in presenting to the public in a genuine form the original ideas of this important book.
Gracias a este admirable realización de la International Marxist Tendency y se logró sumar al arsenal marxista una inmejorable de una obra de gran valía.
Thanks to the work conducted by the International Marxist Tendency, the world has been given an important weapon in the arsenal of Marxism.
Obra quedado parcialmente inclusa por asesinato de Leon Trotsky.
The work which was sabotaged by the assassination of Leon Trotsky.
En la etapa máxima, en la etapa cima madurez política autor.
A work which was the product of Trotsky's most mature period of his life, of his mature thought.
Este arsenal marxista constituye la poderosa arma que tienen los explotados y oprimidos del planeta a forjar otro desde la.
This arsenal, this powerful arsenal of ideas, is the most important weapon in the hands of the oppressed masses of the entire planet in the world today.
En el cual impera la ley de la selva.
I didn't get that. ¿Puedes repetir, Esteban?
Es que estoy... Y otro mundo donde quede cerrada la opción, explotación y violencia.
Fighting for a new world which is free from exploitation and oppression.
Donde los asombrosos avances científicos y tecnológicos se usen el bienestar del ser humano y no para sembrar dolor y muerte.
A world in which the extraordinary advances of technology and science will be put at the disposal of improving and raising the quality of life of the masses, of the majority of the human race.
La aportación de Leon Trotsky al arsenal revolucionario marxista es muy importante y gran valía.
The contribution made by Leon Trotsky to this arsenal of Marxism was extremely important and retains today all of its original vitality and importance.
Ello debido a su participación clave junto a Lenin, así como testigo de primer orden.
Usted está diciendo, repite, Esteban. Es muy distorsionado. Puedes reconectar porque se está fallando nuevamente. Espera un momento, Esteban.
Vamos a llamar otra vez.
Ok.
Correcto.
Ok, listo.
Vale.
Okay. La aportación de Leon Trotsky al arsenal revolucionario marxista es muy abundante y de gran valía.
The contribution of Trotsky is very broad and of extreme importance.
Ello debido a su participación como personaje clave junto a Lenin, así como testigo importante en el asombroso acontecer de la primera revolución socialista triunfante en el planeta.
This quite apart from his fundamental role that he played in the Russian Revolution of 1917, side by side with Lenin, and also his extremely important contribution in the first Russian Revolution of 1905.
Donde tuvo que desarrollar sus fundamentos ideológicos.
When he first of all developed his fundamental theories,
como fue la revolución permanente,
such as the permanent revolution,
opuesta a la inoperante revolución por etapas de Stalin y Bukharin.
In contrast to the anti-Marxist theory of Stalin of the two stages.
La cual terminó en el masacre del proletariado chino por Chiang Kai-shek.
Which ended up with the terrible massacre of the Chinese proletariat by Chiang Kai-shek.
Junto a Lenin tuvo participación primordial decisivo en la realización y triunfo de esa revolución.
Side by side with Lenin, Trotsky played a fundamental role in this great social the greatest social transformation of the 20th century.
Para finalmente, unos años después, a su muerte, Lenin llevar a cabo defensa de esa revolución.
didn't get that again. Puedes repetir, Esteban? Sí.
Para finalmente unos años después, tras la muerte de Lenin, llevar a cabo defensa de esta revolución.
And also to, after the death of Lenin in 1924, to continue the defense of this revolution.
Defensa al avasallador embate contra la revolución burocrática encabezada por Stalin.
Carrying out a life and death struggle against the Stalinist counter-revolution.
Esto fue el inicio de su actividad.
Repite.
Esto fue la propia vida.
The price was his life.
Yes. What?
The price was his life.
Sí, al final, sorry. And finally he paid for this struggle with his own life.
Nadie, Leon Trotsky, analizó y descifró ese nuevo tercer doctor.
Hay que repetir la comunicación, ¿eh? Es que no se entiende, se está rompiendo. Can you reestablish the connection?
Yeah.
Yes.
Am I doing it without video?
Without video,
yes.
But you need to tell us the
number. Vamos a llamar otra vez, pero sin video, que se corta mucho la conexión.
Okay.
¿Ya?
Vamos a ver. Adelante.
Okay.
¿Seguimos?
Sí.
Yeah.
Ok. Nadie como Leon Trotsky analizó y descifró este nuevo acontecer histórico.
Nobody.
What's happening?
Hello? Alex, speak closer to the
microphone.
Nobody. Baja el sonido. Es que baja el sonido. I hate modern technology.
Cold.
What?
Okay. Hola.
Sigue. Pero estaba muy alto, ¿eh? Sigue.
Hola.
Ya. Sigue.
Okay.
Ya, sí.
Okay.
Nadie como Leon Trotsky analizó y descifró este nuevo acontecer histórico.
Nobody analyzed this. What's this noise? What is occurring? It's too loud. Nobody analyzed this new historical phenomenon better and in more detail than Trotsky. Okay, try again. No sound at all.
Yeah,
did you? I don't know. Translate. All
right.
La contra gestada por una voraz y parasitaria burocracia en el seno de una economía socialista.
The struggle against a parasitic bureaucratic caste encrusted within the body of a socialist nationalized planned economy.
Economía con su respectiva planificación y propiedad esta de medios de producción.
An economy based upon the nationalization and planning of the means of production.
Muchas fueron obras
Trotsky wrote a great many works on this subject. Among which is his book The Revolution Betrayed.
Le señala punto por punto el total abandono del régimen de Stalin, de los principios y fundamentos de la revolución bolchevique de octubre 1917.
Which analyzes point by point the abandonment by the Stalinist regime of all the basic principles of the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917.
Y con más de medio siglo de anticipación, predice el retorno al capitalismo de la Unión Soviética.
And was predicted more than half a century beforehand, the collapse of the Soviet Union and its return to capitalism.
En caso, la burocracia sí y este no se ha reconquistado por la clase trabajadora.
It's not clear. ¿Puedes repetir, Esteban?
Repítalo.
Con más de medio siglo.
No, eso ya lo oí. La siguiente frase.
Del capitalismo de la Unión Soviética.
Eso ya está.
De seguir la democracia en el poder.
No. Es que se está rompiendo otra vez. It's breaking up again. Yeah. I can't see what he's saying. I think so, yeah. Sí, Esteban, yo creo que sería mejor más bien empezar la conclusión porque la tecnología está fallando, vamos, malamente.
Ok, que me gusta usted su...
Ah,
ok. Ya hizo la conclusión.
Ok, está bien.
Okay. Okay.
Bueno. El anhelo de todo revolucionario debe ser que los profundos análisis y certeras denuncias de Trotsky
sigue.
El anhelo de todo revolucionario debe ser que los profundos análisis y certeras denuncias de Trotsky.
Every revolutionary should be inspired by the profound and correct ideas of the theories of Leon Trotsky.
Sobre la revolución stalinista.
Over his ideas concerning the Stalinist counter-revolution.
Sirvan evitar la repetición.
Which can serve us as a means of avoiding these phenomena in the future.
De estos procesos degenerativos, futuras revoluciones.
And thus guarantee the success of future revolutions.
Para que se llegue a un genuino socialismo.
Such that we can finally arrive at a genuine socialist society.
Con auténtica democracia, libre de dictaduras burocráticas.
And not fall into the trap of a bureaucratic regime.
Aún resuenan las palabras de Leon Trotsky.
The ideas of Leon Trotsky still maintain all their vitality.
Dirigidas a Socialist World Party de Estados Unidos.
Despite the distortions of such organizations as the Socialist Workers' Party of North America.
Nunca hubo tarea más grande sobre la tierra.
Nunca.
Nunca hubo tarea grande sobre la tierra.
Nunca hubo tarea más grande sobre la tierra.
There was never a greater task on the face of the earth.
Llevamos sobre nuestras espaldas.
We carry on our shoulders
una partícula del mayor anhelo género humano.
A particle of the destiny of the human race.
La lucha por un mejor mundo.
The struggle for a better world.
El partido crucifixo. Entrega total y completa.
Which demands a complete and absolute dedication on all our parts.
A cambio, da la satisfacción.
In return, we have the satisfaction
de que nuestra vida no habrá sido vivida en vano.
In knowing that our lives have not been lived in vain.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
The book that we have produced today contains nearly 100,000 more words than the original book produced in 1946. That shows the amount of editing that was carried out by Charles Malamuth. He said that this was irrelevant and wasn't germane to the real story being told. And therefore, despite translating it from Russian, he dismissed it. At the same time, as he cut out these words from Trotsky, he actually put in his own words into the book. I don't mean one or two words. For instance, in the original chapter 11 of the book, of the 1946 edition, Malamuth's words account for 62% and Trotsky's words 38%. So you can see by that balance how much he was prepared to foist his own ideas into the book in order, I presume, to boost his own particular prestige. And it's not for any reason really that Trotsky did say that he thought that Malamuth was very pretentious. I think this is an example of this feature. And in one way, we were very lucky to come across this material. Like everything else, accidents do happen. And I just happened to be looking for somewhere to stay when I was visiting the United States. And it just so happened that my wife's cousin lived in Boston, so I could get somewhere free to stay. So I went along there and I realized, here's Harvard University very close by. And in Harvard University is Trotsky's archive. I've heard a lot about this archive, but I've never seen it before. So I thought it would be a good opportunity to go and see the archive for myself. And when I got there, I was very taken, I'm very surprised, first of all, by the scope of the collection. Trotsky was very meticulous, and he recorded and duplicated practically every single thing he wrote, and kept it in an archive. And in 1940, just before he was assassinated, in order to keep the archive safe, because it was being raided, in fact, Soviet secret police tried to burn the archive in Prinkipo and elsewhere, that he agreed to sell the archive for safekeeping to Harvard. And in this archive, even from the period 1929 to 1940, There are 20,000 pieces, 20,000 documents. Gives you an idea how fruitful Trotsky's ideas were. I went then with the express idea of looking for material on British Trotskyism, but I haven't been shown the prospectus. I just, in the short time I was there, glanced through it all as much as I could. Because I only speak English, I don't speak Russian or anything, and there's a lot of material in foreign languages. But my eye then caught on documents on Stalin. And I bought this book, this is the second volume, in 1969. And the first part is great, and the second part is full of this Malamuth's dejections. And I did remember reading this, and it said in there that, when I was editing the book, I couldn't edit all of it because the pages on the manuscript was damaged in the struggle. Apparently, he said that the galley proofs were in Trotsky's office when he was murdered. And in the struggle, the manuscripts, some were destroyed, covered in blood, and so on and so forth. So I looked at it, I thought, how much have you got here? How many manuscripts are there? And they had 9 boxes of this material, 9 boxes. So I decided to have a quick look through these boxes. I couldn't do it a lot. I had to go back the following year, and I went through every single piece that was in there. There was no destruction, there was no blood, there was nothing. Everything was in perfect order. And then it had the correspondence of Malamuth, of Natalia, of Albert Goldman, and others, and their comments that they were making at the time. As I said, they tried to stop this book being produced because of this, because of the insertions of Malamuth and the political incorrect ideas he was trying to smuggle into the book. And when they saw the drafts that were going to be published, they were scandalized. And you could read the drafts and all the comments they had. This is scandalous. This is a crime. This is hot historical revisionism. This must not be published. And the whole all it's full of these comments. Of course, when they took up these complaints to the publisher refused to acknowledge them. All they were interested in is getting the book out and making money from the book. They weren't interested in Trotsky's ideas, of course. And you could see the anger, if you like, expressed in this way. Then I noticed that there were a lot more material there than were in the original book. And I went back to the library with this particular book and started to look at, compare what had been printed with the actual manuscripts. And I could see then there were chunks taken out, just huge chunks missing. And then I found in these 9 boxes, there was a section which had said unpublished material. Well, I thought this could be useful. It's a bit of a gold mine here. Opened all up, and it's all the material which was translated into English, but not used in the book. So under those circumstances, I thought we must correct this. We must get this material, and we must take out Malamuth from the original and put this material back in the book. It was all numbered, although the numbers itself didn't give you, it was still a very messy job to say the least. So we ordered the microfilm. Cost us, I think, £400 for the microfilm. And then we had to have the microfilm film made into hard copies. And from hard copies, we had to have a comrade type up those copies. I think it took him 2 years because it was so difficult some of the to understand and follow the tract. And once it was done in a Word format, we were then able to put it back into the book. Then we discovered, in working on this book, that there was a Russian translation, And we thought, let's compare the Russian translation to what is in the English book. And there were sections of the Russian in the Russian book which didn't appear. So in other words, so we retranslated, Alan in particular, translated all this material that was in Russian into English, and that was put into the book itself. So you could say this is the most complete version that you could ever have, probably. Obviously, it's not the book that Trotsky would have completed, that's clear. But nevertheless, using all the material that was available, we decided to put everything into the book. So it becomes a complete a text that was available to us at the time. And in that way, we thought this is a means of restoring the real honor of Trotsky. There were 10,000 words of Malamuth in there we took out. So you can imagine how much that was. And clearly, nevertheless, some of the notes were very rough, and therefore it was down to editing. I think Alan took about 2 years, or was it more, 3 years, in editing and basically reworking the book, and also putting it into chronological order, rather than the haphazard way which was done in 1946. And if you compare the books, you'll see that it's an enormous change. In fact, you could say that the second part of this book is new. It's get like a new book, because the material is all put in together, reworked, redeveloped, refined, and really does it a colossal justice. That's why Esteban Volkov was basically over the moon. When he heard that we were going to do it, he was, this had gone on for 10 years, and he was pressing us and pressing us and pressing us to do this. Of course, we had other work to do. So it was a bit of a slow process. But finally, we, because I remember, I think it was in 2012, I did put an article in the IDOM magazine saying that this book would be out in 6 months. So there was a bit of an underestimation on my behalf there. And of course, the main thing for us was not just to get it done, but to do a good book, to do it justice, and to make sure we do the best job we could. And that's why we took our time a bit, if you want to put it that way, and worked on it and worked on it and worked on it. And even when we'd finally thought we'd completed it, there was always some other material that we managed to get from the archives. And therefore, this is certainly a labor of love. But once you read it, it's one of the most powerful books, I would say, and ranks up with Trotsky's History of the Russian Revolution. It is certainly the most mature work of Leon Trotsky in his analysis of Stalin and of Stalinism, and is an enormous contribution, therefore, to the new generation of Marxists in Britain and internationally. So I think we've done a good job. We can pat ourselves on the back. But of course, the question now is to sell and promote the book as well, which we'll talk about in towards the end. But now I want to call on Alan to speak. And we will have time for, I think, a few questions. And then we'll have a bit of time at the end if you want to buy some of those books. Even get Alan to sign them. So it's even that's even good for you. Okay, so without further ado, I'll call on Alan to address you.
Pass me the 10. That's great. Pass me the book also, though.
What?
Give me the book. One of the writers of antiquity, a Roman writer, once said a very profound thing. Every book has its own fate. And this book, which I'm holding in my hands, has, in my opinion, the most extraordinary fate, perhaps of any other book in history. This is a book that was never supposed to see the light of day. Stalin was determined on that. And on the 20th of August, 1940, one of Stalin's hired murderers, as you know, assassinated Leon Trotsky, drove an ice pick into his brain while he was reading an article, treacherously, a cowardly attack from behind, destroyed one of the finest brains of the 20th century. And when he was assassinated, Trotsky was working on this book. Now it's true, as Esteban pointed out, this was not an initiative on Trotsky's part. You see, superficial observers, how many of them are there? For every one serious critic, you've got 1,000 idiots. And superficial analysis, people like Isaac Deutscher, other people, never understood this book. Many of them thought, they believed, and they believed, that this was a kind of act of personal spite on Trotsky's part. Trotsky was having his revenge on Stalin. Well, nothing of the sort. Nothing of the sort. Trotsky didn't intend to write this book. As a matter of fact, it caused him considerable irritation when he was asked to write it by Harper. But he needed the cash, as simple as that. Yes, he didn't go into this book with any particular desire to do this. But once he started, he produced, in my opinion, one of the most profound and fascinating documents in the entire literature of Marxism. And that's saying something. This book, in my view, is original, it's unique, in the sense, although it's true, that Marx, if you like, preceded this in one of the marvelous gems of Marxist literature, of historical materialism, which I hope you've read. If not, you should read it. The 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. Marvelous work. Now, one of the continuous insults which they smears, which they persist in repeating against Marxism, is something like this. Oh, Marx, yes, he reduced everything to economics. Have you heard that? Yes, you heard it? Yes, yes, I've heard it also, you know. A piece of arrant nonsense, which is far from the truth, which Marx answered a long time ago. What Marx said was, no. Man and woman, in those days, they didn't explain it. It's the same, humanity. Men and women, if you like, make their own history. Men and women make their own history. That's Marx. Yes, but we make our own history. Who else is going to make it if it's not human beings? But human beings do not make history according to their own free will. No. People make history within certain limits and under certain objective processes which affect and limit their actions and determine their actions to a large extent. Marx gave in this wonderful work, the 18th Brumaire, that's an interesting book. It's an interesting parallel with this, because what Marx explains in this book is how this man, Louis Napoleon, Louis Bonaparte, he was Napoleon, he was the nephew, actually, of the great Napoleon, who played a similar role to Stalin in the French Revolution, but he was nevertheless a great historical personage, at least a great general. This man is this creature who became Napoleon III, was so insignificant. He was an insignificant, sniveling, groveling, gray, boring idiot. Okay, and that's only to refer to his positive features. Took power in France. How do you explain this? He He took power against people that were far more capable than him, but he took power. So such a mediocrity he was, that the famous French poet Victor Hugo described him as Napoleon le Petit, Napoleon the Little. How did this man, this mediocrity, succeed in coming to power? Now that's an important question. And also the question arises here. How does it come about that Stalin, you know, the trouble here is, as you well know, history is written by the victors, always. That's why the voice of the working classes, the masses and so on, the downtrodden people, they never heard in history or heard in a very distorted way. You only find about Spartacus, the great hero of the Roman Republic, leader of the masses, all that we know about Spartacus comes from the writings of Spartacus's enemies. And even so, his wonderful character shines through. History is written by the victors. And the Stalinists, with this huge propaganda machine that they had, just imagine, a propaganda machine, this monolith which controlled all the printing presses, the cinema, every aspect of Soviet life under Stalin, under this horrible dictatorship, produced a flood of material about Stalin the genius, Stalin Lenin's faithful disciple and comrade in arms, Stalin the leader of the Russian Revolution, Stalin the hero of the Civil War, Stalin the father of the people, and so on and so forth. Yes, on the contrary, Stalin, like Louis Bonaparte, was a complete and absolute mediocrity. Like Napoleon le Petit, this is Stalin, a mediocrity, who played next to no role in the revolutionary war. He played a secondary role, wouldn't be fair to say that he played no role. He had originally been a Bolshevik. Yes, but a very narrow type of Bolshevik, a narrow type of revolutionary, which the Russians used to call the committee men and committee women. The committee men, narrow organizational type, necessary for the party. The organization apparatus is necessary to any organization in history. Whether it be the Social Democracy or the Conservative Party or our organization, you do need an apparatus, an organization. The problem is that in a revolution, a genuine revolutionary Marxist organization, the apparatus must not control. The apparatus men and women must never control the party. That must be in the hands of serious, dedicated, honest revolutionaries. Stalin was an organizational type. So the question arises, how did he come to power? How did he succeed in defeating men and women who in every respect were his superiors? You take the leaders of the Bolshevik Party, Lenin's party, it was a galaxy of enormous talent. These were great people, all of them intellectuals. All of them, by the way, intellectuals who had experience of working abroad, who spoke foreign languages fluently, who had a high theoretical level. Stalin was the exception on the Central Committee. No serious education, educated in a seminary. And by the way, if you read his speeches and articles, you can see it smells of incense, it smells of the seminar, of the language of a priest. Narrow as hell, ignorant and so on. Spoke no foreign languages, except for Russian, because Russian was not his language, he was a Georgian. Same as Napoleon was a Corsican, that's an interesting parallel. And Hitler was an Austrian, Hitler was not German. He was an Austrian, but he became a complete German chauvinist. Napoleon was a Corsican, but became an absolute defender of French centralism and the oppression of the Corsican people. And Stalin also became an absolute, out-and-out, great Russian chauvinist, who spoke Russian badly, by the way. It wasn't his language. Spoke no foreign language. A fairly ignorant, narrow kind of person. And yet he defeated men and murdered giants like Bukharin, even Kamenev and Zinoviev, Trotsky, of course, General Tukhachevsky, a military genius, hero of the Civil War. These people were wiped out. I'll come to that. You know, but the question is, how? Why? Now, to a simple mind, and there are so many simple minds among us, I find, it goes like this. If Stalin won, he must have been clever, cleverer than Trotsky, and Trotsky must have been a bit naive or stupid or inept or something. Not so. Marx explains in the 18th Blumen, and it's a fact, that there are certain objective periods in history which demand mediocrity. That's particularly true of the history of revolutions. I've just been studying in preparation for the school, I hope you'll come on Monday, about a subject which we don't discuss officially, the English Revolution. And by the way, there are very serious parallels, extraordinary parallels in the processes of the English Revolution, the French Revolution, above all, and the Russian Revolution. You see a similar phenomenon. And in these revolutions, you will find there's a period, an initial period where the revolution is going forward, a period of revolutionary ascent, the heroic period of the revolution. France is the classic example. England also, Russia, of course. But let's take the French Revolution. In the French Revolution, there's a period of storm, of stress, of advance, where the revolution is going forward, where the masses are involved, where they're sacrificing, they're struggling, they're participating. And this is a period of giants. The heroic period demands heroes, and by God, they were heroes. People like Danton, Marat, Saint-Just, Robespierre even. These are the products of a period where the revolution is going forward. But you see, if the revolution does not reach its declared aims, if it disappoints the masses, if it hits the buffers, if you like, and begins to go into decline, the whole thing begins to unwind. It goes into reverse. And in that kind of period, the period of revolutionary ebb tide, where the masses, if you like, are tired, exhausted, as they were in Russia, and who can blame the Russian working class? After years of war, revolution, and civil war, hunger, starvation, and so on and so forth, privation, and the rest of it. But the workers, by the time Lenin had died, the working class in Russia was exhausted. It was a period of ebb tide in which, and that's the explanation for the rise of the bureaucracy, which, by the way, Marx predicted in advance before he wrote the Communist Manifesto in a marvelous work called The German Ideology. I think it was written in 1845, where he and Engels wrote the following. In any society where poverty is general, where there's not enough to eat, in any society, is this working? In any society where misery, where poverty is general, Marx wrote, all the old crap revives. And he used the German word. All the old shit revives. And by all the old shit, what he meant was precisely inequality, bureaucracy, corruption, oppression. That's an inevitable situation where you don't have the material basis for socialism, and that was certainly the case in Russia. In this period of decline, in France, it's summed up by one man you've probably never heard of, Joseph Fouché. You ever heard of Joseph? Probably not. Oh, yeah. Fouché was a terrorist, an ultra-left, if you like, a terrorist Jacobin, who became, first of all, a supporter of Thermidor, Thermidorian reaction, then a supporter of Napoleon Bonaparte, and finally a supporter of the Bourbon monarchy that was restored. And he became a duke and held important positions throughout. Joseph Fouché, an opportunist, a careerist, a groveling, unprincipled wretch, and a complete mediocrity, a bureaucrat, if you like, arrives at a position of power because of the ebb of the revolution, which has not got any room for any other sort of teaching. Same in Russia. The isolation of the Russian Revolution, don't forget that the perspective of Lenin and Trotsky was not the Russian road to socialism, was not socialism in one country. The October Revolution was meant to be the first step in the international revolution, particularly the European Revolution, the German Revolution, which could and should have succeeded if it had not been for the betrayal of the social democratic leaders. But that's a separate discussion, a separate question.
Once the European Revolution had been defeated, once the German Revolution had been defeated, the Russian Revolution was isolated into conditions of the most frightful backwardness. One figure, I won't bore you with a lot of figures. In 1 year, 1920, 6 million people starved to death in Russia. There were cases of cannibalism. How can you talk about building socialism on that kind of basis? No, 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 no. The working class was exhausted, was disappointed, was beginning to become apathetic, was not participating, as it had done. And therefore, the bureaucratic caste, and by the way, when we say the bureaucracy, we're not talking about one or two pen pushers. We're talking about a caste of millions of privileged officials, millions of former Tsarist officials who began to feel that they were in charge, that they were going to take power. Yes, but this caste of Tsarist, in the main, they were Tsarist officials. Lenin said, and he was worried about this, in his last speech to the Soviet, to the Moscow Soviet in 1920, I think it was, he said, look, you take the Soviet state, 1922, I believe, you take the Soviet state and scratch it wherever you like, scratch it wherever you like. And beneath the thin veneer of Soviet democracy, you will find the same old Tsarist state apparatus underneath, the same old officials. And these officials, of course, they weren't interested in socialism, they wanted power for themselves, they wanted privileges for themselves, they wanted to lord it over the workers, but they required a cover, particularly as there was only one legal party, the Communist Party. They required a leading Bolshevik that would reflect their interests, that would speak for them, that would be in their image. And that man was Joseph Stalin. He was the representative of the bureaucracy. Now the question is, why did Trotsky lose and why did Stalin win? Well, that's the reason for it. Trotsky, after Lenin's death, tried to base himself on the working class, but it was a working class that was small, was demoralized, was hungry, that was already beginning to fall into apathy, was not up to any serious struggle. Whereas the bureaucracy, this caste of millions of officials, was becoming more and more confident, more and more aggressive, more and more assertive, and seeking a political leading position. That had to be an old Bolshevik, and that was Stalin. Therefore, Trotsky was defeated because the Russian working class was defeated. That defeat, by the way, was inevitable. I'll tell you something else. Trotsky knew that it was inevitable. He knew. He knew in advance the left opposition could not win under those circumstances. So why did he bother? Why did he fight? Others capitulated. The realists, you know, like Zinoviev, Kamenev, others, they capitulated in the hope of saving their life, in the hope even of starting some kind of an opposition. No. Every single one of them was murdered by Stalin. Trotsky stuck to his guns. Stalin made a big mistake. He expelled Trotsky. He couldn't kill him at that time. It was too early. 1929, I think he was expelled, wasn't he? Not from the Soviet Union, that is.
Yeah.
27, he was expelled from the party. 29, he was sent to Turkey. Ended up in a little island, a godforsaken island called Prinkipo, where the Ottoman emperors used to send the Byzantine people that were, or rather the Byzantine emperors used to send troublemakers to that island. And Stalin was convinced, because he was a bureaucrat, because he had that mentality, he was convinced Trotsky was finished. Because what was Trotsky going to do without an apparat, without the apparatus, without hundreds of officials, without even a typewriter? What was Trotsky going to do? Big mistake. From the island of Prinkipo, Trotsky continued his opposition and tried to put together the forces of the left opposition. Come back to the question. You might ask, why did Trotsky, but if he knew he was going to be defeated, why continue? Only for one reason. Trotsky was fighting to preserve the genuine ideas of the Russian Revolution. The genuine ideas of Lenin, the genuine ideas of October, the ideas, the principles of workers' democracy, Soviet democracy, and proletarian international. That was the thing. Preserve this for the future generations, for us comrades, for all of us that's in this hall, and for the movement which still bears his name
today. That was what he was fighting. The others did. They thought they could play hide and seek. They thought they could play Zinoviev and Kamenev and Bukharin even. Thought they could play fast and loose with Stalin, play fast and loose with them. Thought they could maneuver and intrigue. No. Stalin destroyed them. Exterminated them physically. By the way, here's an interesting question for you. I realize, of course, that what I'm saying tonight is not fashionable, is it? Not at all. Particularly in these temples of wisdom, you know, the universities, you know. What's the line? The line is, no, my friends. There's no real difference between Lenin and Trotsky and Stalin. They're all the same. Stalinism is an inevitable product of Bolshevism. You heard of that? You heard of it? You haven't lived. You haven't been doing your studies. You must be living in another planet. It's constantly, no, Stalin was the product of Bolshevism. False. It's a lie. And by the way, anyone that says that to me has got to answer one simple question. If Stalinism and Bolshevism are the same, if Stalinism is the inheritor of Bolshevism, how does it come about that in order to consolidate his bureaucratic and totalitarian regime, Stalin had to murder every single one of Lenin's party, the leadership, all the Central Committee? One exception, Kollontai, I don't know why, ended up in Sweden. But not just the Central Committee, he murdered millions of people. Okay? Not just old Bolshevik. I think they recently reviewed the book in the Morning Star. I'll have to answer that chap. I'll have a bit of fun with that Stalinist in the Morning Star. One of the things he says, oh no, it isn't true that Stalin only killed the old Bolsheviks. No, it's not. He killed a lot more people. He killed a lot of Stalinists. But yeah, no, seriously. Millions of people were exterminated in this monstrous meat-grinding machine, this regime of terror. And the question again arises, why? Why, for example, was Stalin so terrified of Trotsky that he devoted all his time and energy to assassinate this one man in Mexico? What was he afraid of? Well, I'll tell you. You see, Stalin had been a Bolshevik. And he knew from his own experience that a small organization like Lenin's organization with correct ideas and correct methods can, under certain circumstances, grow and become a serious threat. And he didn't feel at all secure, Stalin, as a matter of fact. And therefore, he was determined to eliminate. All the old Bolsheviks were slaughtered with the monstrous purge trials, the Moscow trials. Which they were so monstrous, the only thing that I can compare them to is the Spanish Inquisition. And these Lenin's faithful supporters, people like Bukharin, Zinoviev, Kamenev, were tortured, blackmailed, their families were threatened, until eventually they broke. People can only take so much torture and punishment. They broke and they capitulated, one by one. The leading people capitulated. Many Trotskyists, that is to say, by the way, not Trotskyists, many Bolshevik Leninists, Trotsky didn't use the word Trotskyist. He described himself that we are the Bolshevik Leninists, the continuators of Lenin. Many of them did not break. They were arrested, they were tortured, they were beaten. They were sent to these hellish concentration camps where they were starved and worked to death, beaten, and so on. And even in these hellish places in the Arctic Circle, freezing with cold, 40 degrees below zero, these ragged prisoners, men and women, maintained their party discipline, maintained their classes of Marxism, discussed international events, even conducted struggles and strikes in order against the criminal regime of the prison guards, in order to preserve some kind of dignity and some kind of rights. They even succeeded in Vortuka, coal mine in the north, in the frozen Arctic. So they succeeded in winning this struggle. When Stalin heard about it, he issued the order. And one day in 1937, the prisoners, the Trotskyists, were led out in groups of 20 men, women and children above the age of 12, marched by the guards into the frozen tundra, and they were shot. And while they marched to their deaths, they sang the Internationale, and they cried, "Long live Lenin, long live Trotsky." Comrades, that's the real tradition that's represented in this hall today, and the real tradition represented by Trotsky. One man against the whole world, by the way, with all this monstrosity. And Stalin didn't stop at his political enemies. He took his revenge on their families, on their children. One by one, Trotsky's children were murdered. Esteban Volkov, my old friend, that you just saw him there, his mother, as was stated, committed suicide in 1930, driven to suicide by Stalin in 1933. Trotsky's eldest son, Leon Sedov, was active in the left opposition in Paris, was murdered after an opposition by GP, Stalin's agents in Paris. And the cruelest blow to Trotsky and his wife was his youngest son, Sergei, who was not involved in politics. He wasn't involved in it, he wasn't an oppositionist. He was a mathematician, not involved in politics. Stayed behind in Russia. They thought they wouldn't touch him because he was not active. Big mistake. Stalin caught him. He was tortured to denounce his father, which he refused to do. Taken to a concentration camp and shot. Disappeared. Trotsky and his wife didn't know what happened to Sergei. This is the kind of monstrous regime that we're talking about. We're talking about the biggest, the most ferocious, the cruelest, and the most efficient murder machine, perhaps in the history of the world. The GPU, the Russian secret police, had endless resources. Its arms extended, its tentacles extended everywhere, infiltrated everything, including Trotsky's own circle. We know, how do we know? Because some of these creatures, some of the GPU officers survived and wrote their memoirs. And from these memoirs we know that every morning on Stalin's desk in the Kremlin was the latest articles and speeches of Trotsky, articles in particular. Stalin got the articles before the Trotskyists got them, because of these infiltrators. So he followed Trotsky's ideas very, very closely. One man against the whole world, imagine it. One man against the whole world. Nobody, by the way, would take him in. None of the so-called democracies, the right of asylum, which they talk big about nowadays. They let Marx in, they let Lenin in before the First World War, not Trotsky. Systematically refused by Britain, by the United States, and so on. The only country finally that would let him was Mexico, which at that time was under, 1938, was under left-wing president, Lázaro Cárdenas, who did accept Trotsky. Genuinely. And again, from Coyoacán, from Mexico, thousands of miles away, Trotsky continued the struggle. And these same superficial creatures, like Isaac Deutscher, Deutscher actually wrote in his, don't recommend that three-volume work, but it's rubbish. Deutscher actually wrote that the last 10 years of Trotsky's life was more or less a waste of time. It was like a barren desert, nothing compared to the time when he was leading the Red Army, and it's true Trotsky created the Red Army from nothing, which defeated 21 armies of foreign intervention, saved the Russian Revolution thereby, or the time when he led the Russian Revolution along with Trotsky, along with Lenin, so much so. You read any newspaper, British newspaper, the Times at that time, you'll find that they referred to the Bolshevik Party as the party of Lenin and Trotsky. That was the general. Stalin was nowhere to be seen. All the time, when he was 26 years of age, in 1905, was the president of the St. Petersburg Soviet of workers' deputies. And many other things, many other things. Compared to that, Deutscher says, what did he achieve in this last period? And yet, you know, that was not the opinion of Trotsky himself, not at all. Trotsky wrote in his diary, in exile, he wrote the following, which is not for publication. It is available. He says, look, if I think of my whole life, since he entered the revolutionary movement at 18 years of age, he was sent to Siberia for revolutionary activity, 18 years of age, since I've been in the movement, if you ask me, what is the most important period of my life, I answer, it is now. Why? He says, because I am fulfilling a role which nobody else can do, because of the destruction of the Bolshevik Party. I alone, Trotsky alone, was maintaining this banner of Bolshevism, the spotless banner of Bolshevism. For that reason, Stalin had to get rid of him. He issued the order that Trotsky must be killed. There were even protests, actually, we know this, from some of the officers of the GPU responsible for work in Latin America. Comrade Stalin, why are we wasting all this money on just one man, Trotsky? We've got other things to do in South America. Professor Stalin said, no. You must get rid of Trotsky. Get rid of Trotsky, and he was right on one thing. He says, because the Fourth International does not have good leaders. He was dead right on that. They don't have good leaders. Therefore, get rid of Trotsky and the whole thing will be finished. An actual fact. And when Stalin heard, because he did hear, that Trotsky was writing a biography about him, you can imagine his reaction. To go back to my earlier question, which I didn't answer, why did Stalin have to resort to this mass murder? Well, you know, Joseph Stalin was one of the biggest criminals in the annals of human history. Compared to him, the crimes of the Borgias and the Roman Emperor Caligula pale in insignificance. He was a monster. He genuinely was a monster. And the question is this. All criminals always seek to remove witnesses. The witnesses must be eliminated. And there were many witnesses to Stalin's past, to the fact that he didn't play the role which he claimed to have done in the revolutionary movement, and the fact, of course, of his terrible crimes that he committed against Lenin's party and against the Russian Bolshevik Revolution. And Stalin succeeded. He succeeded in exterminating all of the witnesses. He got rid of them in the most brutal fashion imagined, except for one. The most important one, the man he most feared, the man who knew most about him and his regime and the party and also the genuine traditions of October. And that's contained in this book. That was the reason. I don't say, by the way, that this book is the reason why Trotsky was killed. It wasn't. That decision was taken before. But that it expedited things, you better be sure of it. And Stalin was keen that this book should never see the light of day, because he was afraid of what it would reveal, and it reveals a great deal if you read it. But you see, just to round up, you see, when Stalin heard the news that the assassination of Trotsky, which he so desired, had finally succeeded, he must have been extremely pleased. Yes, he must have been delighted. And he must have thought, well, that's it, that's that finished. We hear no more of this. But you see, when you think about it, it is not a difficult thing to murder a man or a woman. We human beings are very weak animals, very fragile beings. Anything can kill a human being, a bullet, a knife, an ice pick, a bomb, anything. Yes. However, you cannot murder an idea whose time has come. And that's what Stalin never understood, this narrow, ignorant, petty bureaucrat. Never understood that. Never understood the power of ideas. Marx said, ideas can become a material force when they grip the minds of the masses. And the importance of ideas is that Trotsky understood that. And that's why the last period of his life was the most decisive. The books that he wrote, as Esteban put so well, a part of an important arsenal. There are weapons. Stalin proceeded with guns and knives and pickaxes and slander. Our weapons are different. Our weapons, the only weapons we possess, is the weapon of ideas. And it is a very, very powerful weapon indeed. And therefore, this book, which I and Rob and other comrades are proud, very proud
to have had a role in giving to the world a book that was never supposed to see the light of day, and it has, thanks to our tendency, and it will have an effect. This book, in my opinion, is a Marxist masterpiece, which is worthy to stand alongside such masterpieces of Trotsky as The Revolution Betrayed, In Defence of Marxism, and The History of the Russian Revolution. And therefore, I appeal to every comrade in this room to get this book and read it thoroughly from start to finish. And you will find that it contains a colossal amount of information, of facts, and of course, of theory, of explanation, very profound theory things on philosophy, not just on the immediate issues, but on Marxist philosophy, on the history, on the historical materialism, and the role of individuals, and so on. It is a fascinating study, which should serve to arm our comrades, arm the new generation. That's what Trotsky wanted. The only memorial that he ever wanted was this. The power of ideas to inspire and to convince and to motivate, the only force that can change the history of the planet, which is the working class, once it is armed and led by conscious Marxists dedicated to the only struggle which is worthwhile carrying out and sacrificing for in the 21st century, the struggle for the emancipation of the worldwide working class.